होप माई स्क्रीन इज विजिबल. सो कैन एनी वन गिव मी अ ब्रीफ आइडिया अबाउट वॉट वी आर ट्राइंग टू डू? Can you tell me the theme on which this entire section which I gave you to read was based on?
Basically, we are in the relationship between the reproductive number to the whole probability of existing in the disease till the end waves, ma'am, till the dawn.
Okay, very good, Harshita. Anyone else? Would you want to rephrase it or add something to it?
Ma'am, there was also a mention about how if the disease persists, then each node will become a root node to the successive child nodes.
Okay, very good, ma'am. She correct. So that is the idea which is used in recursion. So starting, I think, page 676 onwards. So what is happening here is, I think we talked about it in last to last lecture. We were interested in finding out whether your disease will reach till the level infinity or not. So if I start from this level, which is my first level, K children, so on and so forth, if I reach at level infinity, what do you think? What is the probability that any node will be infected here? So in case there is at least one node which is infected here, we say that the disease has become an epidemic, otherwise not. Right, and we have looked at two expressions for that. So we work till level n. So we looked at what is the probability that infection persists till level n, and we have figured out two formula for that. So do you remember that?
1 minus p into q n minus 1 whole to the power k.
1 minus p q
PQ n minus 1.
N minus 1.
Whole power k, ma'am.
Whole power k. And this was also in 1 minus, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Did you understand how we got this formula exactly, or does anyone want me to repeat it? No one wants me to repeat it. Shall I go further? So we are having this here QNS. Okay, and we are interested in finding Q infinity, right? So that seems a bit difficult. So how do I put limit n tends to infinity here? So we are going to do this in a slightly different way. So what I am doing is, I am looking at this function here. So I'll just copy paste this to another page. Okay, and here we also know one more thing. What is Q of 0? Can someone tell me what is Q naught? So Qn is the probability that at least one node at level n is infected.
Right. Ma'am, according to the test book, it will be 0 now, ma'am.
So you think about one. Forget the textbook for a while.
It will be 1, ma'am, because it will we know that.
Exactly. So it will be 1 because we know that root is infected. So what is Q naught? Q naught is the probability that at least one node at level 0 is infected. And we know that there is only one node at level 0, and that is given to us that it is infected. Right? So now what is Q1 going to be? Q1 is going to be 1 minus 1 minus P Q0 whole to the power K. And we know that this Q0 is nothing but 1. Right? So it is 1 minus 1 minus P whole to the power K. This is Q1. Okay, what is Q2? Q2 is now 1 minus 1 minus P Q1 to the power K. So now Q1 will come here. So in that sense, it's a recursive function. So how we are going to solve it is, I'm going to take this function here, f of x, right? I'm going to repeat this screen back and forth, and I'm writing f of x is 1 minus 1 minus px whole to the power k. So this is the same thing written here. I have written this as f of x, and I have replaced this thing by x. Right? So this is my f of x. Now I know what is my Q0? Q0 is 1. Right? Vamshi explained us how it is 1. What is Q1 now? Can I say that Q1 is f of 1? Look at it carefully. Can I say Q1 is f of 1?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Can you tell me what is Q2 now?
It will be f of 2 now, ma'am. Or
will it be f of 2 or will it be something else?
Something else, ma'am.
F of 1 into f of 1 or something like that, ma'am.
Yes. So how do we come to that? So I know that Q2 is 1 minus 1 minus P Q1. This is Q2, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And what is this entire thing? Can I say this is nothing but f of Q1?
Yes, ma'am.
So Q2 is f of Q1. And what is f of Q1? Q1 here is f of 1. So can I say that it is f of 1? Similarly, if I look at Q3, Q3 is a function of Q2, which is what f of Q2 is. So Q2 is f of Q1. So f of Q2 is f of Q1. And Q1 is f of 1. So it becomes f of 1. Right? So let me write it like this. I say this is f of 1. This is f11. F21. This is f31. So on and so forth. So what is limit n tends to infinity of Qn? It is going to be f of infinity times 1. So this is what we want to find out. Any doubt till here? So my aim is, I am given this function f of x. I have to figure out what will be the value of. So I'm first going to look at what is f of 1. Then I want to look at what is f of 1. Then I want to look at what is triple f of 1. So on and so forth. Right? So for that, we'll have to look into some of the properties of these functions. So how will f of x look like? So let's take it to the next page. So now we are going to plot this f of x. Let's say this is my y-axis, this is x-axis. So the page which Harshit was talking about tells us about some of the properties of these functions. So first let's look at what is f of 0. So let us see what will be the value of this function at x equals to 0. So what is f of 0 here? Can you quickly compute and tell me?
0.
F of 0 is 0, right? So here I have 0. So this is my first point. And what is f of 1?
HP bar k.
F of 1 is 1 minus p whole to the power k, right? So in case p is 0, then f of 1 is 1. If p is 0, f of 1 is 0. So it depends on the value of p. So let's say p is somewhere between 0 to 1. It's not exactly 0, it's not exactly 1, but something greater than 0. So can I say that f of 1 will be something less than 1? Or rather, let me say less than equal to 1, but I'm not taking equal to 1 case here because the value of p cannot be 0. So can I say that f of 1 will be something which is less than 1? It cannot be greater than 1.
Ma'am, it can be less than or equal to 1 because there might be a certain probability of disease passing on to the Q1.
It can be, yes, it can be equal to 1 also. So why I'm not taking it equal to 1? Because it is equal to 1 when p equals to 0. That is, the probability of disease passing is equal to 0. And in that case, this entire analysis does not make sense, because that actually means that there is no disease itself, if the contagiousness of the disease is 0.
But if we can assume p equal to 1, considering it passes to the second level, that is Q1.
If p is
possibility.
1, yes. So if p is 1, that means that definitely the disease will keep existing. Then also we don't need this analysis, right? If p is 1 means every edge will transmit the infection and every node in the network will be infected. If p is 0, then no node in the network will be infected.
Okay.
So those are two extreme cases, right? So in case p is 0 or in case p equals to 1, we don't need this analysis, because if p is 0, then definitely the disease cannot be an epidemic. Rather, no one will be infected, only the root will be infected. If p is equal to 1, then every person in the network will be infected and the disease is definitely going to be an epidemic. So we are not taking these two cases. So for any other value of p, if you look at f of 1, its value will be less than 1. Here, let me say this is the line y equals to x. So this is not my function. This line represents y equals to x, right? And if this is y equals to x, let's say here is the value of x, then this point here, it's going to be 1, 1. Now, if I look at my function, f of 0 is here, something which is 0, right? Just a second. And let me say this is the value where x is 1. And let's denote our function with a blue color. So this is f of 0, and f of 1 will be somewhere over here, right? It has to be less than 1. What else can we say about this function? So if you do some more analysis with this function, calculate its derivative, calculate its second derivative, you will be able to establish that it's a concave function. Furthermore, this is a monotonically increasing function. So this function cannot be something like this. It's always going to be monotonically increasing function. Also, so now if it's a monotonically increasing function, it can actually take two paths. So this function is concave and monotonically increasing. So either this function will look to you something like this, or this function will go below this line, a concave function going below this line, right? So it is either, let me take this point maybe slightly up somewhere here. Then either this function is going to go like this, cut this line y equals to x at some point and then merge here, or it's going to be something like this and then merge here. It's always going to be below this line. And how do we compute that, whether this function is going to be above this line or below this line? So for that, we calculate the derivative of the function. We look at its slope at x equals to 0. So how do I determine the slope of this function at x equals to 0? Can someone tell me how do we find this law?
Derivative on the basis of f and put f equal to 0.
Can you do that? So you differentiate this function and you equate it to 0.
I mean, that's the traditional way of finding this law.
Yes, so that's what we are going to do. We are going to use the traditional way. So take the derivative of this function, what it's going to be. So derivative of 1 is 0. Then you do the derivation of this entire thing. So this is with respect to x. It will come out to be minus k 1 minus px to the power k minus 1. Right? And then you take the derivative of this inner part, which is 1 minus px. Derivative of 1 is again 0. Derivative of minus px is minus p. Right? So it turns out to be p into k 1 minus px to the power k minus 1. Right? And we equate it equal to. So this is the slope and we are finding this slope at x equals to 0. Right? So you place x equals to 0. So this becomes 1 minus 0. This becomes 1 to the power k minus 1. So you get the slope of this function as p into k. And what is p into k? R naught, right? It is a reproductive number, R naught. So if I look at the derivative of this function f of x, it is nothing but a reproductive number, R naught. Now, we were having two cases. So we had to figure out what is this f infinity times x when R naught is less than 1 and when R naught is greater than 1, right? Those were the two cases. So we wanted to show that when R naught is less than 1, then its value is 0. And if R naught is greater than 1, that it has some positive value. So don't worry, you might be lost at some places. This is not a very easy derivation. Feel free to ask doubts or also feel free to refer to the textbook to gain a clear picture of what is happening. So the whole idea is you should be able to think in terms of probabilities and functions. Okay, so what if R naught is greater than 1? Let's see that case. So if R naught is greater than 1, then slope at this point is positive, right? So it's going to be above this y equals to x. Cut it somewhere and this function is going to go something like this. Right? And this is the point. So this is the value of f of 1. Right? Now we want to find the value of f dash 1. f of 1. So by looking at this figure, can you figure out there's a very simple method of finding f of 1 here. So what if I move horizontally here? Right, till I intersect this line y equals to x, what will be this point where I'm intersecting this line? What will be the coordinates of this point now? So this was x is 1, y is 1. Here x is 1, y is f of 1. Now I came horizontally here. So what is the value of x at this point? Anyone? Nothing hard here. So what I'm saying is the coordinates of this point is 1, 1, and that point actually doesn't matter. So let me write it down again. And the coordinates of this point is 1, f of 1. Right. So here the value of x is 1, value of y is f of 1. Now I'm horizontally moving from this coordinate till I meet this line. So what I'm asking you is, what are the coordinates of this point? What is the x value here and what is the y value here at this point?
f of 1, f of 1,
right? Because the y value remains same because we have moved horizontally. So the value of y here is f of 1. And since this line represents x equals to y, so x is going to be f of 1, right? Next, move vertically down from this line and come to this point. What is this point going to be? So now the value of x remains the same, which is f of 1. And what is the value of y? So the value of x here is f of 1. And this line represents, this curve represents this function. So the value of x is f of 1 here, right? So will not the value of y be f of 1 here? Right, this line represents the function y equals to f of x. And x is f of 1 here. So y is going to be f of 1. So you keep moving in the same fashion. Now again come horizontally here. If you look at this point now, it will be f of 1 and f of 1. Come down. When you come down, this point will become f of 1 and f of 1. Right? So you keep moving horizontally, vertically, horizontally, vertically. And what will be the point where you will stop? So you are going to stop at this intersection, right? So as you go down, you keep repeating this infinity times. You are actually going to converge at this point. And what is this point? We do not know the exact value of this point, but we know that this is some value which is greater than 0. Right? Here both the values of x and y will be greater than 0. So we have established that when r 0 is greater than 1, what is happening to this function f of infinity times? It's actually converging to a value which is greater than 0. Right? Which means that your disease will be epidemic, not necessarily, but with certain probability which is greater than 0. Basically, it means that there is a chance that your disease is going to be an epidemic. Can you now do it for the other case? So this was the case when R naught is greater than 1. What will happen when R naught is less than 1? You can actually refer to the figure in the textbook. Right? What will happen in that case? So if I remove all of this part from here. In that case, you will see the slope is negative, so this will be something like this. Right? Or am I doing something wrong? Unable to draw it here. This will come slightly below from this, right? Because the slope is less than 0. So let's say it should always be increasing. So you draw it in that particular way that it is always increasing, something like this. You can refer to the figure for a more accurate picture. And here again, if you look at this point, so this point is what? X is 1 here, y is f of 1. You again go here, again go here, again go here in the similar fashion as we did in the last case. And here you will converge all the way to 0. So this establishes that when your reproductive number is less than 1, then there is a 0 probability that your disease will go epidemic. It won't go epidemic. It will die at one point or the other. Okay, any doubt till here? I have one more thing that I wanted to discuss with you. So what we have done in last to last class, actually I made a small mistake there. So we were interested in figuring out what is the probability that at this nth level, there is at least one node which is infected, right? And we have used, this recursive formula was the one which we came up. There was one more way in which we tried to write it down. Do you remember what was that? We said that, what is the probability that at least one node is infected here? We said that it is equal to 1 minus probability that no node is infected here. right? And what is the probability that no node is infected here? It is probability that a node is not infected here to the power k raised to the power I, because there are k raised to the power I nodes here. And then we saw that what is the probability that a node is not infected here? We said that it is 1 minus probability that the node is infected here. And the probability that a node is infected here is p raised to the power I. So this was another expression we wrote. So there is a slight problem with this expression. It actually doesn't hold true. So I want you to think about this. What is wrong with this expression? Can anyone guess? Did you think about it? So let's say I'm talking about this level 2 itself. So at level 1, I have certain nodes. Then this is at level 2, right? So let's say n equals to 2, and I'm trying to figure out the probability that at least one node is infected here. Then I cannot go by this formula and write it as 1 minus 1 minus p square to the power k square. This is actually incorrect. Okay, so think about this, why it is wrong. If you want to discuss it with me sometimes, you can. So think yourself for some time and then you can ask me. Okay, you can go back to the notes if there is any doubt in the overall process, especially this function here. Make sure you ask me and I'll post the quiz in next 5 minutes. So I'm giving you time till 4:10. Go through it and ask me if there are any doubts.
Ma'am?
Yes, Mamji.
So regarding the, you said there is a problem in the formula, right?
Yes.
So this formula 1 minus and this 1 minus p of q whole power k, if you take out the 1 minus part, this 1 minus p q minus 1 whole power k represents that every single node in that level is not infected.
Come again. So are we talking about this formula 1 minus p I k to the power I?
No, like if we take for q n minus 1, that means in the n
that row, other formula is correct, that one, no, q n equals to 1 minus 1 minus q n minus 1 to the power k. This is the other one, right? P b hai yahan pe, 1 minus p q.
Yes ma'am.
This one is actually, this one is correct. This one has a problem. But come again, what were you thinking? Tell me, let's think aloud.
No, I got confused and I was thinking like, so 1 minus p into qn minus 1 whole power k represents that in the qn row, like in the generation of qn, every single node, that is the probability of every single node being not infected.
So let me repeat here again. So here, you know, this qn minus 1, it is actually not representing a level here. Let me quickly repeat this again. So how do we get this formula? So this is my level 1, right? This is my level 2, and at some place this is my level n. So we are looking at qn, probability that a disease exists at this level. So what we have done is we are sort of saying that, so if there are these k people, so we are saying that if your disease exists at this level n, it would have come either through this path, right? So there are k such paths. First, this would have been infected and then it would have come to the nth level, or from here, from this second path, or from this third path, or from this fourth or the kth path. So these are k paths through which my disease can come to the nth level, right? So I say that qn equals to 1 minus probability that all these paths fail. Let me say all these k paths fail here, right? Any doubt here? So the disease comes here if at least one of these paths is able to transmit the disease down till the kth level. Right, and then we look at what is the probability that a particular path will fail. Right, so I can write it, probability that a path fails to the power k. Right, so that qn minus 1 is actually representing a path here. Now, what is the probability that a path fails? So let's take a path. Let me talk about this path here. Right, this path means it infects this first node over here, and then from here my disease come down till the nth level. So what is the probability that it fails, right? So I say that probability that it fails is 1 minus probability that it passes. It's able to pass on the disease. And what is the probability that it will be able to pass on the disease? It will pass on the disease if, first of all, this guy is able to infect this guy. So a P for that. So P here represent that this root node is infecting this node here. And for the remaining thing now, this node, so given that this node is now infected, what is the probability that it can bring down the disease all the way to the nth level? So that thing is written here as qn minus 1. So qn minus 1 represents that this node is infected here. So now this n becomes n minus 1 for this node. So for this node, the level was n. For this node here, the level becomes n minus 1. So if this node is now the root node, what is the probability that infection traverses all the way till n minus 1? So that's why we had a qn minus 1 here. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So this formula is actually correct. So the problem was in this way. So if we do it like this, we say that what is the probability that at least one node is infected here is 1 minus probability that no node is infected. And we say that probability that no node is infected is 1 minus. So there are k raised to the power I nodes here. So what is the probability that one node is not infected here? Is if we write it like 1 minus p raised to the power I. So this formula, which sort of comes more simply, seems like more simple, is actually incorrect. This one is correct, the one for which we did this entire derivation. The questions in the quiz are simpler, so maybe I can share the quiz with you. That will give you a more, I would say, concrete idea into what is going. And don't worry if you didn't understand this derivation entirely. It's slightly involved. Even it took me like 5 times of reading to fully understand it. So the questions you'll get in the exam will be sort of similar to the question you will see in the quiz now. If no one has any more doubts, shall I share the link? Okay, so this is a 10 minutes quiz. Time is now 4:15. So let's say you start from 4:16. I'll close it at 4:26. We'll discuss the solutions in the next class. You can use a calculator for your calculation, so no need to do everything by hand. Or I'll give you time till 4:30, till the end of the class. You have 15 minutes. Go ahead and do it. I'll close it at 4:30. Harshit, take care this time to submit well in advance. Guys, are you listening me?
Yes, ma'am.
So there is a small problem with the last question. So last question is actually, what is the probability that at least one of the nodes E, F and G is infected? It's not E, H and K here. So just take a note of that.
Ma'am, can you tell again, ma'am?
I'll type it in the chat window. So your last question is, it's actually repeated as your last third question. Your last question is, what is the probability that at least one of the nodes E, F and G is infected? I have typed it in the chat window also. The form is about to close. All of you please submit. I'll close it in next 20 seconds. So make sure you submit your answers now. And then we'll discuss the solutions in our next class. Oh, I'm ending this meeting now and will close the form in next 10 seconds.